This is Mark Bell from SuperTraining Gym. SuperTraining Gym, the strongest gym in the West. And today we're at Slingshot World Headquarters and we're doing a Q&A with the people's coach. The first thing is not a question, rather it's a response that somebody had to the Stoic Philosophy video that we shot about equanimity. I just wanted to give a shout out to Zachary Lindsay. I really appreciate everyone's participation on this channel. Again, I want you to think about this YouTube channel as being different from a lot of other YouTube channels that you may get an opportunity to see, because this one, I want it to be interactive. I want to hear your voice. I want to see your comments. And Zachary, well, he wasn't sure. He's like, I don't know if Mark Bell's actually, you know, reading these comments, but I do. I try to answer questions and I try to encourage you guys to continue to share information. Remember, this is a mentorship. I am going to assist and help you guys the best way I know how, and maybe you can help and assist each other. Let's try to bring all of us up. So if you have information that you think that would be useful to me in a particular video, please put it in the comments below. You have information that you think will help someone else out, whether it be diet or whether it be kind of words of wisdom to live by, or whether it's just motivation to get someone outside for a walk, we would really appreciate it. We are giving away Occupy Your Mind shirt to people randomly. We're gonna put them into a big old mixer and we're gonna spin that wheel and we're gonna see who gets an opportunity to win. The only thing that you have to do in order to get into the mix is comment in the videos, and then we will, I guess from there, we'll figure out a way to get in touch with you. Zachary Lindsay said, your advice has helped me through a dark time and gave me clarity. One thing I'd like to say is I hear people say that very often. They say a dark time. What I would love for everyone to try to practice, you don't have to do it. I'm not gonna force anyone to do anything they're not comfortable with. But I'd really love for people to stop utilizing those terms, dark times. And I know that sometimes maybe we just say that so that we're not embarrassed about whatever it is that we went through that was tough. But things are tough and things are rough for all of us. So whether you're addicted to pornography or addicted to drugs or whether you had somebody die, to me would be more embarrassing. It would be more embarrassing to not get the information out there to assist people. So, you know, do your best and use your own discretion. Again, I'm not trying to shame you into sharing your information, but I do hear people say that all the time, dark times. I would love for people to elaborate on that, because I think sometimes somebody's feels very shameful about maybe the fact they cheated on a spouse, they end up with a divorce, they end up with A, B, and C. But man, how much more useful could it be if you said, if you got that information out there into the universe and said, hey, this is what happened, this is what I did, you know, I ended up, you know, being addicted to cocaine for 4 or 5 years, and whatever the situation is, I think it's helpful to just get it out there, and I know it can be difficult. And then he goes on to say, God bless you, sir. I don't know if it's actually you replying in the comments, but I really appreciate it. That you care about the people really means a lot to me. It's very admirable, and you are an incredible person. That may or may not be true. For helping all these people, including me, for nothing in return. That's the trick right there, is that it's not for nothing in return. You know, I feel I was put on this earth to make the world a better place to lift. And if I'm gonna do that, I need strong, healthy people around. I'm a big believer in mind, body, and spirit. Lifting weights is not about just getting underneath a barbell and lifting the weight. It's about having a more sound body, having a more sound mind, having a more sound spirit. Body, mind, spirit, soul, whatever, however you wanna attach these things together. So we got a couple questions to get to on our Q&A. This one is in regards to the carnivore diet. Is cow milk okay on a carnivore diet? Now, I'm gonna, you know, make this relatable to more of you by saying, let's forget about the carnivore diet in general. But I would say in most cases, many people that are going to coach you, especially through physique transformation or through a bodybuilding style regimen, most would be against dairy under most circumstances. Now, if we're just talking about some weight loss, you can certainly drink milk and lose weight. In fact, there's a lot of evidence and a lot of research shown that a lot of people that grow up drinking milk often have less of a an issue with being obese later on. But I think it depends on what you have that milk with, right? Maybe you're starting to, you know, pour that over cereal and things like that. And that's where maybe you're having chocolate milk every night or something like that. And again, none of those things are gonna make you fat. Milk is not going to make you fat. Milk has a good amount of fat, carbohydrates, you know, sugar even, and protein. But remember, it's not any one thing that's going to make us fat. It's the overconsumption of food that ultimately is the biggest thing that we have to try to fight against. Milk is a great thing to think about in terms of how we can control our nutrition, how we can control our diet. When we try to have milk that has less fat in it, it's less tasty. Getting milk that has no fat in it, getting skim milk, just doesn't taste nearly as good as regular whole fat milk. That's because we start to mix carbohydrates and protein and fat together, and we end up with something that really tastes delicious. When we start to pull stuff out of there, much like half and half is really good, or heavy cream is really good, and they're okay by themselves, but they're so much better with something slightly sweet. Is milk a great diet food? I don't believe so. Is milk good for the carnivore diet? If you could figure out a way to monitor it, I would say that it can fit into really any diet, but it gets to be difficult, especially with whole milk. You end up consuming a lot of calories. Now, if you're somebody that wants to gain some weight, I've utilized milk. I've utilized raw, full fat milk several times on a carnivore diet to gain weight and to bulk up, and along with some heavy cream as well. And it helped a ton. I was able to gain about 20 pounds actually. It was over the course of maybe like 2-3 months or so where I just really jacked the calories way up. So that might be something that you might find useful if you're looking into weight gain. But if you're trying to lose weight, which is most people, most of the time, most of the questions that I get, then I would just say you're probably better off without it. Lastly, I'll say you can do what my boy Tom did. So with Tom here at Slingshot, I've had him lose about 30 pounds. He's looking amazing. He's getting all shredded up. We'll do an entire another video talking about Tom's diet. But what I did with Tom is he started out the diet with milk. He started out the diet with more options, and we dwindled it down. We took him from a place where he had maybe, you know, 30 or 40 different foods, and now he's got like 10. And so he doesn't have as many food options. Moving on. So, you know, just take that information for what it's worth, and you can decide to utilize milk, yay or nay, on your own. I'm not going to really tell you not to, but that's the information for that. This guy says, everyone says to, you know, try to reach 1 gram of protein per pound of body weight. If you are overweight, should we eat grams of protein based on our goal weight? This question has been around for quite some time, and this is advice from a lot of people. Let's just say that you weigh 300 pounds and that you would like to weigh 250 pounds. Well, some of the wisdom that I hear, some of the information I hear, somebody might say, oh, well, just have 250 grams of protein because that's the actual goal weight, and let's hone in on that. While the intentions of that are good, I also realize people that are fat, because I was fat, people that are fat are f-ing hungry. We're really hungry. We really need our food. You can overeat protein and you can overeat fiber, and it will not have any negative impact whatsoever on your physique. It will not have any negative impact on you storing extra calories and getting fatter, okay? It's an important thing to realize, is that you can leverage your protein up a lot before it ever becomes anything that you have to even worry about. You can get into 2 grams per pound of body weight probably. Even if you weighed 300 pounds and you ate 600 grams of protein, sounds like an enormous amount. As long as your calories are in check, I think that you would be okay. What can happen though, a lot of times, is when your protein would be that, you know, if your protein is, you know, getting into like, mine right now is at 400. If your protein starts to get into that range, into the 400 range, normally the only way to choke down that much protein is to have it accompanied by a lot of fat. Thus the reason why eating a chicken breast is way harder than eating dark meat. You might say, oh, dark meat's gross. But still, the fact is that the dark meat is like slipperier, right? It has more moisture to it, has more fat in it. Or rotisserie chicken, or chicken with skin on it is easier to eat. Or how about this, chicken with barbecue sauce on it? I mean, you're either pouring fat on stuff, or, you know, having fat on the food, or you're having to pour sugar on the food, right? Otherwise, it makes it difficult to chomp down. A secret though, is to sometimes eat stuff with vegetables, because fiber is also a thing that's not gonna negatively impact us. You could, you know, have lean chicken breasts and some of these lean meats and so forth, and to be able to get them down a little bit better, you can have that with vegetables, because vegetables are watery and it should help you get those foods down. And vegetables don't really, I know people like cook them in oil and they do all kinds of crazy stuff to them, but they don't really require a lot. Sometimes if you just put zucchini like in the oven or something like that, it's freaking amazing. Throw some salt, maybe some garlic. Maybe you just use like a little bit of olive oil on them and it can help you to be able to eat the protein a lot easier. Anyway, back to the question. So the question is, how should they determine how many grams of protein you eat? I always think that a great place to start is when we're talking about weight loss is to just start with 1 gram per pound of body weight and then work your way down from there, you know, or work your way up from there, just depending on how you're feeling from that. If you feel slow and lethargic in the gym and you feel like you don't have much, bring it up to 1.5, bring it up to, you know, 1.75 or 2. per pound of body weight. To me, I think that that is a more viable, more reasonable thing, because people that are fat, people that are over fat, people that are overweight, they already know that they need to eat less, but man, eating less just doesn't sound like a good time. Eating less sounds to be very, very difficult, very tough. I don't like to try to sell anybody on any of that. I like to add to people's lives and add to people's diet rather than subtract. And the ways that we can add, we've talked about this many times on this channel. We can go for some 10-minute walks every day. We can eat more protein. You can eat your protein till your little heart is just, you know, hits the desired number, whatever that is. We can eat some more fiber, and we can do so through some vegetables. We can drink more water. We can get more sleep. There's 5 things that you can do that I didn't intrude, and I didn't say, hey, you can't eat any carbohydrates. So those are all things to think about. Let's just keep that protein really high, especially for you guys and girls out there that are really struggling with the diet, because the protein is going to help you to gain control of your diet. It's called protein leveraging. Again, I'll go with the statement of saying, you know, just go ahead and eat 1 gram per pound of body weight. Even if you weigh 400 pounds, even if you weigh 500 pounds, just go for it, because you're probably gonna fall shy of it anyway when you're really trying to get those grams in. But I would really, really strive for it, and I would go as far to track it to make sure that you're getting that much protein, because it can be very difficult. All right, I got two questions. One is carnivore related, and one is related to the actual gym. Following up from the previous question, when I started talking about vegetables a little bit, and I started talking about fiber, somebody wants to know, how do they get in fiber on the carnivore diet? Very simple, add in some vegetables. You're not gonna die. There's really no reason for us to have this like hard, crazy stance saying like that we're not going to eat vegetables, saying that we hate vegan people, saying that we hate vegetarians, saying that we hate people that don't eat red meat. I mean, it's a waste of energy is what it is. And it's exciting when you get on a diet, and it's exciting to feel the diet work really well. But you have to think, every single person that changes whatever it was they were doing previously to something better, whether it be that they went from eating like crap to eating vegan, or where they went from eating like crap into a keto diet, or where they went from eating like crap into a bodybuilding diet, or where they went from eating like crap into a carnivore diet, all those people, they're gonna all report the same thing. There's a lot of research and a lot of studies that show this, that the simple change itself is the biggest factor that makes it feel good. And for some reason that gets missed. People don't talk about that often. It's probably just caloric control, or just feeling really good about yourself. You are adhering to something. How good does that feel? You start to fall into a rhythm and you're like, hell yeah, like I got control over this. That's an amazing feeling. Anyway, to get fiber in a carnivore style diet, a really easy way would be to simply add in some vegetables. If you're against that and you don't want to add in vegetables, I would ask the question of like, why are you trying to get in fiber? You know, what is the reason? I think that a little fiber can go a long way. For me personally, I have an orange usually once a day. Sometimes I'll eat a little bit of vegetables like once a day. It just really depends. But if you think that you need fiber to use the bathroom and stuff like that, that is kind of a gray area. I don't really think that that is necessarily 100% true. Although I don't think it's a bad idea. Like, why suffer? Why go through a period of time where you might be constipated just because you're trying to see what the carnivore diet does for you? Now, there could be a reason. Like, occasionally, sometimes people don't digest vegetables very well. So you might have to, people have autoimmune disorders, people have all kinds of things. So you might need to actually go down that road to check it out a little bit for a minute and to see how you respond to that. The other way you can get in fiber is you can just buy like a fiber supplement, you know, and you can have some fiber here and there. But I think people get really obsessed with how often they poop, and they get really obsessed with their fiber. And just recognize that anytime that you change your diet from this diet to that diet, from that diet to that diet, your poop's always gonna change. Your trips to the bathroom are always gonna change. If you eliminate carbohydrates from your diet, you're going to be in the bathroom a lot more because you're gonna be peeing more probably for a few days even. You might be like, wow, I went from like peeing like occasionally throughout the day to peeing like 20 or 30 times in a day. Your body's getting used to something new. Your body's getting used to something different. So give it the amount of time that it needs. The last question here, this is about your knees and your ankles in training. How can a lifter save his knees, ankles, and hips and joints in general from breaking down over time with lifting? The answer to that is to really take care of yourself, and that would include being on a good diet. You want to make sure you have the correct nutrition. I see a good percentage of people, they are not giving themselves the fuel that they need in order to do what they need to do in the gym. A lot of people are trying to train really hard, but they're under eating, and then it makes the lifting very, very difficult, and then their elbow hurts, their knee hurts, this hurts, that hurts. And so I would make sure that you have the fuel that you need to make those gains and make that progress. I would also say, you know, make sure you get a good warm-up. Additionally, I would say that you can gain hypertrophy, you can gain muscle size, you can gain strength, all by doing reps that are anywhere between 6 all the way up to around 20 reps. You can even do more, but who wants to do more reps than that? The problem with doing, like when you start to do really high reps, is that it starts to get very hard to recover from those workouts. So if you did like sets of 50 or something, that would be kind of neat and kind of amazing, but it would be very difficult to recover from those workouts. Just as if you go to the other side of that and you start doing singles and doubles and stuff like that, and you go really, really heavy, those are also hard to work out from. So that's why bodybuilders had landed more in the middle. They landed on like kind of an 8 to 10 rep scheme. And a lot of bodybuilders say, hey, look, if you can't move something around for 8 or 10 reps, then you shouldn't be moving it around. You know, learn how to move the weight around correctly, do the lift the right way. We don't need anything fancy, we just need consistency. You should have a tempo on most of your movements most of the time, and you should be, you know, how many seconds on the way down in the bench press? I'll just say 3 or 4. How many seconds on the way up? 3 or 4. Maybe throw a pause in there, here and there. The same thing with your squats, 3 or 4 seconds on the way down, 3 or 4 seconds on the way up. Same thing with your dumbbell presses. Like most of the stuff that you do in the gym, do it with a good tempo and learn how to do the lift very, very clean. Once you get beyond that point, that's when you can kind of mix in other things. You can go 5 seconds on the way down and try to explode up. Things like that. Maybe pause the bottom for 2 seconds. You can start to really kind of throw a monkey wrench into the whole plan and see how your body starts to respond from that. But in order to keep everything healthy, it's just a real matter of taking care of yourself. Diet comes to mind first. Your sleep comes to mind. Make sure that you're getting in proper sleep. And then if like your knees or something specific is bothering you, I would suggest that you utilize very, very high reps to help rehab the area. A lot of times the area becomes like weakened. You know, the tendons become weak and the tendons become stiff. Right now for me, my knee has been actually bugging me a little bit. And so if I'm to think about, okay, if I come in and I go real heavy, going really heavy isn't that bad because I'm not under the weight for as long, right? However, that's too much stress on the joint, on a joint that's already beat up. Well, what if I go into that 8 to 10 rep range? Well, that's probably still gonna be too stressful. It's gonna cause a lot of soreness to the legs, and it's also gonna kind of leave me limping around for a couple days. So I would be better off really bringing the reps way up, but keeping the weight really super light just for recuperation purposes, just to get a lot of blood shuttled into that area. When we're talking about the joints, we're talking about the elbow, the knee, the hip, sometimes it's just the ankles. Sometimes it's just tough to get like blood flow into those areas. And so we got things like walking, things like body weight squats for 50 reps, leg presses for high reps, things like that. Ultra high reps can be really beneficial when it comes to kind of healing an injury. So you want to go through a time period where you say, you know what, I'm not going to do anything for that body part unless it's in the realm of trying to rehab. Because I have a lot of people who come to me and they'll say, oh man, my shoulder's been killing me. And then I say, okay, well, what have you been doing for it? And they're like, they're not usually doing anything for it. Oh man, my wrist is totally killing me. It hurts every time I bench press. And I ask them what they're doing for it. Turns out they ain't doing shit for it. So you wanna make sure that you're actually doing stuff for whatever it is that's injured. Otherwise, there's no sense in talking about it. There's no sense in complaining about it. In the gym, also utilize this principle, and I've been using this forever on just about everything. The principle of 3, you know, don't do anything that's above a pain level of 3. having a tolerance threshold is a little different than pain threshold. You want a tolerance towards blood filling up in the legs and blood filling up in your biceps and being able to get past that pump and being able to strive to be better than you were yesterday. You want a tolerance for all that stuff. But what we don't want is we don't want to be injured. We don't want to be hurt. And so when something's really flared up and something doesn't feel right, it ain't going to get any better. So give your body the love and the attention that it actually needs. Stop pounding the crap out of it. You know, just pretend that your knee has the ability to speak to you, your hip has the ability to speak to you. And imagine, what would it tell you at the end of the day if you didn't eat properly, if you didn't sleep properly, and then you went to go to the gym and you went to hit a big squat and you've been just, you know, lifting heavy every single week. The hip's going to say, hey, asshole, can you fucking quit it? Like, would you stop? Like, this is ridiculous. You've been asking me to do this for the last 5 years and you're not changing any of your methods or techniques. You just keep doing the same thing and I'm in a lot of pain over here. Try not to, ride those joints until they completely wear out, until they completely bust. Give them the attention they need. Lastly, you can go over to markbellslingshot.com and you can pick up, we make everything. We make wrist wraps, we make knee sleeves, we make elbow sleeves, my wrist wraps. You can even take my wrist wrap and you can wrap it around your elbow. You can wrap it around the knee. I've made things that have protective measures for all the joints in your body, including the flagship product of them all, the Slingshot. Supportive upper body device for bench press, push-ups, dips. It helps alleviate pain and stress from the elbow, pain and stress from pec tears, pain and stress from rotator cuff injuries. It's used by the NFL, it's used by the NBA, it's used by professional golfers, it's used by MMA athletes. I mean, it's used by The Rock, it's used by Superman, it's used by, literally, you think of a person, and I can probably tell you they've come in contact with these products because the products work and they're super effective. Coming out very soon, in about another week or so, we have some briefs. So basically we have a Slingshot version of, we have some shorts that are gonna kind of be a Slingshot for your lower body, I guess you'd say. You can check out all that stuff over at markbellslingshot.com to get all the info you need. Strength is never a weakness. Weakness is never strength. Catch you all later.